Good morning. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We came with one agenda, and that is to lift up the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the head of the great head of the Christian church. Amen. And we're grateful today. God has breathed into us once again the breath of life. And it's just a blessing to be on top of the ground, and ground not on top of you. It's a whole lot going on in this world. And the fact that we have been clothed in our right minds, the fact that God woke us up early this morning and started us on our way, and the simple fact that he put food on our table. You know, as you get older, you begin to appreciate the minute things that God does for you. It don't have to be extravagant. It don't have to be over the top. Anything that God does for you is always in your best interest. Yes. Amen. Amen. Even when it hurts, yes, it's still in your best interest. God is always looking out for all of his people. Even in moments when you don't understand what God is doing, you better believe that he's working it out for your good, but also for his glory. And so just because it doesn't feel good and just because it doesn't look good doesn't mean it's not going to end well. Amen. Sometimes you have to go through a little pain before you experience elevation. Sometimes you have to go through rough times before you get to where God wants you to be. Amen. But this is a journey, and we're up for the journey. Lord, whatever this journey entails, I'm okay with it. Because if you be for me, who and what can be against me? Amen. Amen. So we're grateful this morning just to be in God's presence. It may be a little warm in here. We did turn the air on early this morning. But we're gonna make it through this. Amen. And so let's start out with the word of prayer, and then we're going to hop into the word of God this morning. God always has something to say. I look at it this way. Anytime God calls a meeting, he always has something to say. You have to ask God to give you ears to hear what he's saying to you. Amen. Because whatever might be for you, that part might be specifically for you. But I know that God has something for me. And so, Lord, let me not miss the word that you brought me here to hear this morning. So let's pray. Father, we come to you this morning first saying thank you. Before we ask you for anything, we thank you for everything. You have been one faithful friend. You have been on the whole journey with us. You have seen every minute detail as it relates to the good, bad, and the ugly. And despite everything that you know about us, Lord, we thank you for still choosing to love us. And we believe that if you had to choose all over again, that you would still choose us. And so, Lord, we are so grateful to be in your presence this morning. So grateful that you put breath in our bodies, and you woke us up this morning and brought us to the house of the Lord to worship you. We're not worried about what happened yesterday, because this is a new day. This is the day that you have made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. And the simple fact that we've gone through some stuff and we survived every bit of it, Lord. So we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that through everything that we've been through, that we can still say that if it had not been for the Lord on my side. Father, we pray for our families this morning. We pray for those who are struggling with their mental. We pray for those who are struggling financially. We pray for those who are struggling trying to find a job. We pray for those who are struggling in relationships. We pray for those who are struggling with themselves, God. We pray for those who are struggling with their relationship with you. We pray for those, God, who just don't know how to get along with people. We pray for those, God, who are just struggling in life in general. But we also understand, Lord, if we want better, we have to be willing to do better. If we always do what we've always done, our results are going to always be what they've always been.
Yes.
So we pray that transformation takes place this morning. We want to be transformed. We want to change. We want to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We want to leave out of here with something, Lord. We don't want to leave out here the same way we came, and we don't want your word to be in vain. Father, we pray for our kids. We know there's a lot going on in the schools, shootings, and it's just so much going on, God. And we ask for a shield, that you would shield our schools, that you would protect our kids, Lord, and that parents would become parents again and raise their children to the best of their abilities. And if it's too much for them, God, first we pray that they stop having them. And secondly, God, we pray that they will reach out and get the help that they need, God, to help govern and raise their kids in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Father, we pray that even as adults, that you would help us to have that reverence for you, God, that holy respect, God, that fear of the Lord. Father, let us not become callous-hearted, God. We pray that you would give us a heart of flesh and remove the heart of stone. Have your way today, God. And we will be careful to give you all the honor, the praise, and the glory. Forgive us of sin, because we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Touch us from the top of our head to the soles of our feet, and we'll be careful to give you the praise. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Amen. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continue to be in my mouth. Amen. This morning, I want to give you a simple subject. Amen. I want to give you a simple subject. Simple subject. And I promise I won't hold you long, because I know it's warm in here. Simple subject. Gratitude. Gratitude, thankfulness. There's a lot going on in this world, and all of us, to some degree, are impacted by the things that are going on around us, the things that are going on in this world. But despite everything that's going on, praise God. We up. Despite everything that's going on, we still have a lot to be grateful for.
Yes.
Don't we?
Yes.
The old people, and I didn't understand it when I was younger, they used to say, Lord, if you don't do anything else for me, you have already done enough. And you know, when I reflect back over my life and my journey, I'm so thankful for the things that God didn't let happen.
Amen. Yes. Yes.
Now, I'm grateful, Lord, that you allowed me to go through some rough times. I know what it feels like to climb the rough side of the mountain, but I believe things could have been worse. We've all had some close encounters that reminds us that, Lord, if it was not for your divine intervention, if it was not for your hand in that moment when the enemy wanted to take my life, when the enemy wanted to try to steal my sanity. Have you ever been to a place in life where the enemy played in your head and played with your mind, and he used people to do it.
Right.
Amen. Relationships don't work out and you lose focus of who you are. There are things so much more important than that relationship. But in the moment, you couldn't understand it. You couldn't wrap your hands around it because you were trying to figure out something that you should have been turning over to God. In this season in my life, I'm not trying to make sense of it all. I'm not trying to figure everything out on my own. I just want to be where God wants me to be in that moment. And if I'm not in the right place, Lord, I pray that you would help reposition me. I want God to reposition me. Why do I want him to reposition me? I want him to reposition me for the blessings that he's already laid out for me. See, the things that we are praying for, God has already worked those things out. Many times, the delay is us being out of position. Amen. If you watch sports, it's very important, even if it's cheerleading, even if it's dancing, whatever the sport might be, it's very important for everybody to be where they're supposed to be. Because if you're out of line, then everybody else who's on the team, you're going to push them out of line too. You're going to confuse the whole dance. You're going to confuse the whole play. Why? Because you're out of position. And so one of our prayers should be, Lord, help me to be in the best position, to be my best self, and to receive everything that you have for me. See, because watch this, we have spent countless seasons trying to help everybody else win. Have y'all experienced that? You're maneuvering, you're using all of your influence, you're doing everything that you can possibly do to help somebody else win. And in the end, guess who's left struggling? You. The same energy that you give, it don't always come back. The same people that you help, they don't always reciprocate it. Come on now. Because a lot of us mad at folk now because we done for them and they act like we ain't done a thing. Yeah, and then that's God just showing us everybody is not your assignment. Please don't let that go over your head. If you don't hear anything else, I want you to hear this. Everybody is not your assignment. Well, Pastor, how do you know when they're not your assignment? Because you keep pouring and they don't retain nothing that you pour. You keep on giving and giving and giving, and guess what? You are the one who's left depleted. See, because when you're pouring on an assignment, God always sends you refreshment.
Okay.
When you're on, just like I'm in my assignment right now, this is what God called me to do. And regardless of what I might have going on in my life, God is going to give me what I need to do this right here. Why? Because it's my assignment. But I want to talk a little bit about gratitude and being thankful. And I promise you, we got about 30 more minutes and we're going to be out of here. I want you to look at 1 Thessalonians 5:18. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. And if you have your phone, you can look at it on your phone. To be thankful means to be appreciative. It means to be grateful. It means to appreciate the things that God has done for you. And we want to just look at a few verses pertaining to this subject. 1 Thessalonians 5:18, what does the Apostle Paul write here? First he says, in everything, what?
Give thanks.
Give thanks. When you're up, give thanks. When you're down,
give thanks.
When you get your income tax, give thanks. When you spent it all, give thanks. When you get your new boo,
give thanks.
And when you buy yourself,
give thanks.
Paul says, I don't care what you got going on in your life. Every day and every moment is an opportunity for you to give thanks. Listen to this. Somebody can't give thanks this morning because their alarm clock went off and they didn't move. I kind of watch YouTube a lot, so I do know what's going on in the real world. Some folks think when you're a preacher, you ain't supposed to know nothing that's going on in the world. Well, let me tell you, I know what's going on in the world. Amen. And I know that there's a lot of stuff going on with fentanyl. There's a lot of people dying young. Rich homie Kwan, 34 years old, found deceased on his couch while his girl was up there asleep. Didn't even know her dude was downstairs dead. Because supposedly he OD'd on a pill. Right? Now, I ain't never been no pill popper. But I've done some things in life that should have killed me.
Amen.
Y'all didn't hear me.
Amen.
Y'all not being bougie on me, are you? I said we have done some things in life that should have taken us out. But look, we sitting here praising God this morning, not because we crossed every T, dotted every I, done everything right. We've had our hands in some stuff it shouldn't have been in. And we survived those things. And so when I say that every day is the opportunity for you to give thanks to God for the things that should have killed you, that you're looking back on and lifting up your hands and saying, Lord, I know if it had not been for you on my side, that I wouldn't be here today. Clothed in my right mind. I know folk that used to do hard drugs, and when I look at them now, they look like a trophy of God's grace. You can't tell me what God won't do. There's a lot going on, and a lot of things that should have taken us out, we survived. How can you not believe that God is real when he shows you each and every day how real he is? And so when Paul says, in everything, give thanks, he meant that. When you don't have enough food, Lord, we're going to stress this. Yeah. When you got more bills than bank, Lord, I'm going to pay the most important thing first. When you taking care of those kids by yourself with hardly any assistance, Lord, I don't know where it's going to come from, but I know you sitting on the throne, and whatever problem I have down here, it ain't bigger than you. And when I'm trying to better my life, and I'm surrounded by people who say they love me, but their actions are showing me contrary to what they say. See, y'all. Some of y'all got to get you some new friends. Because if I share good news with you and you ain't as happy as I am when I'm sharing it with you, whoa. Now, you listen. I'm not listening to what you say. I'm watching your expression. Because sometimes what you're saying and what you're expressing are clashing, and that's a red flag and warning sign for me. I need some folk around me who believe in me before God does it. I need you to believe in me when I'm struggling.
Right.
Yeah. That's why we are here. Because we are all struggling.
Yeah.
Everybody's struggling with something. I wish the church would have been put that message out there. And stop making people think that the people who go to church more often are better than the people who don't. Tell the truth.
You come the most because you need it the most. I'll be here every Sunday. I'm not here just preaching to you. I'm preaching to us. Why? Because we need it. So he says, look at First Thessalonians. I want to go back up to verse 12. No, move forward. Let's move forward. Go to verse 16. That's 1 Thessalonians 5, 16. What did he say? He says, rejoice always. How often does he tell you to rejoice?
Always.
Always. Now, joy and happiness are not the same. Okay? Once you understand that, it'll make a whole lot of sense. Happiness has everything to do with what's happening. Right? So if what's happening is not pleasurable for me, then I become unhappy. Right? I can only be happy when what's happening is conducive to what I want. But when you have joy, joy reaches down way deeper than happiness could ever touch. Because joy is a fruit of the Spirit. If you read Galatians chapter 5, you'll see one of the fruit of the Spirit is joy, peace, happiness, goodness, long-suffering, patience, all that stuff, love. All that is a fruit of the Spirit, meaning that if you are a child of God, you, and we said this last week, you have access to all of the fruit. Y'all didn't hear me. And joy is something that nobody can take from you. You can be on your job and can't stand the folk you work with. Let me paint a picture for you. You walk in and they start rolling their eyes. They wish you called out. Some of y'all jobs that bad. You hate going to work and they hate to see you coming. And tomorrow is Monday. And what does that mean? You going to work. Okay, so when you go back tomorrow, there ought to be something different this Monday. Now, you didn't do so good last Monday. you didn't do so good last Monday, but since you came to church this Sunday, we're going to try it again this Monday. Right? And so when I go to work tomorrow, I'm not going to allow them to dictate my temperament.
Okay.
Lord have mercy. I got something for tomorrow. I'm going to walk in and I'm going to see you roll your eyes, first of all. I'm going to listen to your slick tongue. You moving stuff on the desk, hiding all my stuff. You being real slick. You know what? But what I'm going to show y'all tomorrow might be something you ain't seen in a while. Because I know y'all are saying, them holy rollers, look at them. Watch me get under their skin and do all that. This is what Satan's children like to do. Yeah. And I ain't even going to lie. Some of these church folk do it too. But when you go in tomorrow, this is what you got to do. You got to tell yourself to stay focused. And you have to, watch this, joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me. And the world cannot take it away. Now they're going to try. Because since you came to work, we don't want you to be happy coming. Right? We're going to do, because listen, some of y'all work with some petty folk.
Yep.
Some of your supervisors petty.
Yes.
Some of your lead people petty. Yep. And let's just be real. Sometimes you petty. Yep. Oh, since y'all want to be petty. Oh, that's what you want to do today? Then that's what we're doing today. You took it there. Remember, you asked for this. I know Pastor said it's joy, but see, you working my last nerve today. Then the word reminds you, this battle doesn't belong to me. Vengeance is the Lord's. Whew. Now, the Lord just dropped this on me.
Okay.
Because some of y'all want to pay somebody back. I don't know who it's for, but somebody came in here this morning and they said, I'm going to get them. I'm going to show them. I don't care if it's your baby mama, your baby daddy, your ex-husband, your ex-wife, your cousin who keep playing. Yeah, I'm going to show them. They going to stop playing with me. Your in-laws. Mm-hmm. What does the Bible say about that? Now I got to make you see it.
Okay.
Turn to Romans.
Never.
Whew. Tommy is preaching. What does it say, Tommy?
Never.
Romans chapter 12. I got to show them though. So they can't say, Pastor said. Now, Pastor said, never pay back. No, Pastor was just reiterating what God been saying. So I'm going to show you. Now, I'm going to start with verse 9 because, first of all, it says, let love be without hypocrisy. That means get fake love out your life. Oh, God, the Holy Spirit is really slinging his sword this morning. Get them fake people out your life. They're not that valuable that you need to keep them even when they're being fake. Whoo, Lord, have mercy. You are not that beneficial to me to expect me to keep you, and you got every sign of being fake. No wonder I don't have any real friends, because all the fake was in the way. Let love be without hypocrisy. Then it says, abhor, that means abhor, what is evil, get away from it. Some folk are just plain evil. And the sad thing about it is that you like when they're evil as long as it ain't against you. Because I guarantee you, if somebody rubbed you the wrong way today, you got some folk on speed dial that you will use their evilness to combat. Yeah, them folk rubbing you the wrong way. You know who to call. Now, I like when they evil as long as they're not evil toward me. See, but it ain't about you. God has called you to be an ambassador, meaning that you are on assignment at all times to try to win people to him. And people watch us. It's some folk that just like to watch you. They watch your stories on every platform you post on. They're just watching you. Now, everybody that's watching you ain't trying to mimic you, ain't trying to be like you. Contrary to popular opinion, some people watch you because they admire you. Some people really do admire you. Some people admire how you move. Some people admire how you poise yourself. Some people admire how you can be a whirlwind harnessed. Meaning, because the wind will cool you off on a hot day, right? When the wind blows, everybody's like, the wind feels amazing. But that same wind on another day can flip your car. That same wind can cause you to run for shelter in your own house. And usually when you're in your house, you feel like this is the safest place to be. But sometimes the wind make you doubt that, right? Man, is God about to blow the roof off my house? All I'm saying is that we know where you're from. And we know your family. And we know y'all used to throw them hands. And people know you got it in you honest. But they love how you don't always promote that. They love the fact that they know it's in you, but how you harness and carry yourself. Because all of us got that dog in us. Don't pull it out. Because if you take it there, I believe I got one or two members in here that just need extra prayer. Amen. Lord, help me. But the Bible says, leave room for God to be God. You will live a less stressful life when you stop fighting battles that you should have given to God. Sometimes, don't you just want to walk around unbothered? Like, even if you run into somebody that you know been dragging you behind the scenes. Like, what you gonna do? Like, what's up? Now, that ain't the attitude that I wanna have. Now, sometimes we can just have that edge. Because I got an edge to me, but and I pray that the Lord keep me contained. Because I know what's in me and I know what to pray for. Lord, just let me stay calm. You know, like, Lord, keep me near the cross. These are prayers that you pray for you before you start praying for others.
Right?
Walking up to folks, I'm praying for you, all on Facebook, putting up the prayer hands and all that stuff. You ain't even praying for yourself. And plus, you ain't gonna pray for them. They just need to move that emoji. Just do away with it. Just do away with the emoji. Because y'all ain't praying for real. When the last time you picked up the phone and you knew somebody was going through something, and instead of putting up the prayer emojis, you inbox them and ask, what's your number so I can pray with you? Because sometimes people need prayer. They need to hear it. And they need it now. It is urgent. And you have what it takes to reach God. Everybody don't know how they got it, but they just don't know they got it. But if you in church and don't know that you got access to God, what church you been going to? You should always know that I don't care what you've done, where you've been, and what you've messed up. You should always know that you can petition the throne of grace. Now, some people will make you feel like you can't. Man, every figure in the Bible that did amazing things had a crazy past. Moses wrote most of the Old Testament. And did you know that Moses was a murderer? Did y'all know that? That Moses killed a man, covered them up, and then moved away. Amen. But God redeemed his life and used him mightily. All I'm saying is don't let what was keep you out of what could be. Right? Because God is trying to move you from here into the land of Canaan. Canaan represents that land. I used to hear the old preachers talking about Canaan. I used to always wonder, what are they talking about? They keep talking about Canaan, Canaan, Canaan. And then I realized that Canaan was a fruitful place. That's all it means. It was a specific place, but it also represents a fruitful place. A land that is flowing with milk and honey. So when God makes you uncomfortable at times, it's because he's trying to shift you. And listen, stop making life about everybody else. I was talking to somebody yesterday and they were saying that sometimes you got to look out for yourself. Like you giving and giving and giving and people don't even appreciate you pouring. And you're left empty, dragging, aging. Why? Because you letting people stress you out. You got to look out for you. Because mental health is a real thing. I used to hear people talk about mental health, didn't have a clue of what they were talking about. So I realized that maybe I'm going through some stuff mentally too. And I realized how real it was when I had to ask God, the Lord change my mind. Lord, I need you to, move some things out. I need you to replace those thoughts with some new thoughts. Let me give you another couple more scriptures. Colossians 3 and 17. It says, And whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord. You see what he's saying? He says, whether you're speaking or whether you're actually doing something, in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father for him. And Psalm 107 verse 1 says, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. And so when the psalmist says, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, let me remind you, because he's good, that's a reason to give him thanks. Okay. I don't need the Lord to put me in a mansion or to give me a car off the showroom floor in order for me to know that he's good. He don't have to do more stuff for me, because many of us equate goodness to the more they do for me. No, God don't have to do nothing else. What if you never got another home? What if you lived in your apartment to your last breath? What if that's the car you have now is the only car you ever have? Would you look at somebody else's life and say he's better to them than he is to me? No. You got to stop measuring yourself by the standard of other people. Because once you start looking at somebody else's life and then comparing it to your life, then you lose contentment. You can no longer say that I am content in whatever state that I'm in. Whether I'm up, whether I'm down, whether I have much, or whether I have learned to be content. That's what Paul says. I believe that God blesses contentment. When you are thankful for what God has done, I believe that he makes room to give you more. That's what I believe. When you, that person always walking around complaining about something, like the children of Israel did, and because they complained, they stayed longer. I don't want God to keep me in the position I'm in because I'm ungrateful for what he's already done and I can't give him thanks for where I am. You have to learn how to bless him where you are. That's why the scripture says that I will bless the Lord at all times. I don't care where I am. I'm going to give him praise. And I'm not trying to impress people, and I'm not ashamed of my God. We are living in a godless society. Do you all not see how people are pushing away from God? You can go to any church in the city. Ain't none of them packed to capacity. Because people have found something better to do. Somebody close has to die in order for people to come into a church. And that's for the funeral. And most of them ain't going to stay for that. Getting up, walking out of funerals before the pastor has even started preaching the eulogy. What you come for? You could have stayed at home. You could have went to the wake and saw him at the wake. If you're going to come to the funeral and leave out before the message even gets preached. It's fake love, because when you really love somebody or when you really connect to people, you stay for the whole process. I'm staying because I need the family to know that I am here for you. I get so I stopped going to funerals because they're so disrespectful. One time I wasn't even preaching the eulogy and had to get up and tell the people in the back to get out and be quiet because nobody else would do it. And I just happen to know the people and they respect me like that. And I told them, go on out there. The doggone pastor can't even preach in peace. Because people don't have the capacity or the ears to hear anymore. The funeral wasn't for the person that died. The funeral was for you to hear. The dead person can't hear nothing. They can't smell no flowers, feel no hugs, or hear nothing you say. Is for you. And God is reminding us every time there's a funeral or a eulogy or anything like that, he's reminding us that he made a promise that in the day that you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will surely. It's a reminder. I don't care how fine you are, you're gonna die. Yep. Don't care how healthy you are, you're going to die.
Yes.
Yep. Don't matter how much money you make per year, you're going to die.
Yeah.
And when you die, you're going to meet your maker. It ain't going to matter about nobody else leaving before you and who you left behind. The only thing that's going to matter at that point is your relationship with him. This society is so caught up in themselves, so caught up in what they can achieve, so caught up in material possessions that they have been distracted from God. And so they made their stuff their God. I'm not saying because you didn't come to church this Sunday that, and we passed you. I used to think that because somebody was at the car wash washing their car while I was going to church, that, man, they should be going to church too. No, they probably went early. They probably went to early service. Stay out of old business. We talking about you and the simple fact that you got to get it right while you can. You got to get it right while you can. If God has no place in your heart, then don't be surprised when you close your eyes and take your last breath and you stand before him and he said, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. But I went to the church where Pastor King was preaching that. He was like, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. You went to church, but church was never in you. Yeah. You too busy trying to look good while your soul was thirsty. And so at the end of all, the only thing that's going to matter is what you've done for Christ.
Amen.
Do you have a personal relationship with him? God takes care of you every single day.
Yes, sir.
And he takes good care of you. But look at how we treat them. I guess I'll go give him some time. Now you feel like he owes you something. He owes you nothing. If he took your breath today, all your family can do is thank you, Lord, for the time that you gave us with them.
None of us deserve his goodness. But the Bible says that his mercies are new every single day. All I want us to do is bring him back into our lives. Give him the respect that is due to him. And fall back in love with him. Yeah. That means some folk gotta go. That means some things gotta change in us. Change is inevitable though. It's gonna happen one way or the other. But be thankful. Try to make it through the rest of this week without a complaint. Ooh, I know it's gonna be good. Listen, we're not worried about the whole month. Let's just try 1 week. And you can't make it through 1 week unless you make it through 1 day.
Yeah.
And you can't make it through 1 day unless you make it through 1 hour.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So we're gonna try to baby step this thing. We're going to complain less and give praise more. That's the goal. Because, Lord, if you never do another thing for me, you've already done enough.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Be grateful. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. If you are truly grateful. He's faithful. He's amazing. He's everything that we need. He's a provider. Somebody might have come in here this morning and you have a need. We don't know whether your need is physical. We don't know whether your need is spiritual. We don't know if your need is financial. We don't know. I feel like somebody just needs some separation. I need some separation from everything that I'm used to. I need to get back to me. And it's hard to get back to you when you always stepping in for everybody else. You got to be happy too. And guess what? You deserve it. You deserve it. Parents, you can't keep living for your kids. So I know a lot of parents feel bad when they tell their kids to get out. Get out. Don't come back. And they'll be the main ones that come back. You don't have to tell certain ones to go on and live your life and let me live mine. Some of them want to do that anyway.
Right.
But kids these days will live in your house and try to tell you how to run yours. Ain't gave nothing on no light bill. Ain't tossed me nothing to pay the water. Laying up in my bed that I bought, all on my couch wearing it out, in and out my door more than me. Yeah. What you have to do is put your feet down and leave it there. No, I'm pushing you out the nest. Because the daddies are quick to be, boy, you better. It be the mamas.
Yeah.
Just got a soft spot for them. My babies. Okay, mama. Ask God to give you tough skin. Because they ain't gonna do no better until you stiff arm them. Y'all come see me, Brandon Grandbaby's over. It's 8 o'clock, y'all need to go ahead and get headed. I'm about to have company. Even if you ain't finna have company, I'm about to have company. And your company is just gonna be you and the Holy Spirit. They don't know that. Amen, bye. Lock your screen door just in case they got a key. Amen. But you gotta go.
Right.
I don't know who that was for, but somebody received it. Let us stand. If there is someone here this morning and you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you have not invited him into your heart, into your life, this is the day to do it. This is the day to do it. Lord, I need you to come in, and I don't need you to be the co-pilot. I need you to be the pilot of my life.
Yes.
If God's the pilot, he'll always steer you in the right direction. But when you make him the co-pilot, you're going where you want to go and expecting him to fix it. Yeah, when you're on that crash course. There's something about God. He keeps showing up. Boy, you hard-headed. God keeps showing up. How some parents do for their kids. It's hard to not show up for your kids. Y'all remember the prodigal son, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did his daddy show up? Yeah. That boy came back home when he came to his senses.
Yeah.
His daddy was on the porch.
Yeah.
And when he got home, his daddy hugged him. Mm-hmm. Didn't like, boy, you stupid for leaving. You know how some parents, they mouth just. Mm-hmm. Boy, you were stupid for more love. Yeah. You got to balance it all. Sometimes they need to be cussed out. But you got to balance it with love. Yeah. Y'all know how we raise our kids. Hey, amen. My mama didn't play.
Excuse me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We don't have that these days. I be seeing kids talking crazy to their parents.
Uh-huh.
I can't imagine.
Ooh.
Oof.
Because I would literally fight my child. Pastor, you'll go to jail. I'll be in the busted paper. And I'm going to be smiling. I'm going to have my fist balled up like this. Like I did. I did it. Yeah. Because ain't nobody that I don't took care of half their life and still be taken care of and doing stuff for them. You will never get away with disrespecting me and think I'm just going to keep my pastor hat on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See, but because before I became a pastor, I was your daddy.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And if you disrespect me, you ain't getting pastor. The church will get him when I go back that Sunday, but you ain't finna get him. No, not right now. And parents be wearing different hats. Like, no, when it comes to your child, the only hat you need to have on is the parenting hat.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Trying to be cool with your kid because they popular at school and all that. I don't care nothing about your popularity. I take you and your popularity out. I just don't understand the new school way of raising them.
I feel
like, yes, you do have to shift and change, but I understand that. And you can't raise your kids how you was raised. I get all that. But I'm going to be honest with you. Some of the old way of raising kids wasn't too bad.
No.
It wasn't too bad because you couldn't talk back to an older person, whether it was your parents or not.
Right.
They'll smack you in your mouth and then tell your parents they smack you.
Yeah.
You say some of these kids these days, the whole family coming. He the star football player on the team. His whole family showed up. But then nobody come to the PTA meeting.
Right. Right.
I ain't even going to get into that.
Mm.
Christ is first. First. Number one. If you need prayer, you just throw your hand up. We'll pray for you where you are. We don't have to know what your prayer is. God knows exactly what it is. We're going to pray. And I'm going to give the benediction. I'm going to pray for the offering. I'm going to do it all right now. And then you can give on your way out. However the Lord leads you to give. Amen?
Amen.
Father, you saw every hand lifted.
Yes.
You know exactly why they lifted their hands. You know exactly what they need. You know how urgent it is. I'm praying specifically that you would give them not necessarily what they want, although we do want you to give them what they want, but even more than that, give them what they need. The Bible says that if we delight ourselves in the Lord, that you would give us the desires of our hearts. And so I'm praying, I'm lifting them up to you right now. Because the Bible tells us where two or three are gathered in your name, that you'll be in the midst of us. And we can ask anything in your name and you'll give it to us.
Yes.
So we lift them up to you.
Thank you.
Because we know that our God does answer prayer.
Yes.
And Father, we pray that you would give us what we need throughout the duration of this week. Help us to not fold. Help us to not go back on what we're striving for. Help us to treat people how we want to be treated, which is the golden rule. Help us, Lord, to harness our emotions and not let people get the best of us this week. This week is going to be one of the most amazing weeks ever. Blood pressure is going to go down. We're going to feel better in our body because we're pushing out negativity this week. We're going to be positive. We're not going to be cynical. We're going to be optimistic and not pessimistic. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in this season. Maybe it's time for us to shift. Maybe it's time for us to do something different. Maybe it's time for us to change our routine. Whatever we need, we thank you in advance for it. Bless us health, bless our health, our minds, our pockets, and keep us from all evil. Bless the offering. Let it be used for the purpose in which it was intended. As we prepare to leave this place and never your presence, we pray that the grace of God and the sweet abiding communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each of us now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the church said,
amen.
Amen. May God keep you and may God bless you. I can't do this. I'm gonna step right back into it.